You are listening to the Hiking Radio Network, where we talk the walk with shows by hikers about hikers for everybody.
Welcome to the Trail Dames podcast, where we speak with women who love to dance upon this earth. This morning, I tried to hit the trail early, knowing I had almost 9 miles of hard hiking ahead of me. I felt fantastic, though, and today's hiking was simply stunning. First, there were rolling hills through this deep green forest, and then all of a sudden there were these subalpine meadows just full of an unbelievable, just colorful wildflowers as far as you could see. My favorite part of the day was later when both sides of the trail were thick with these vibrant purple flowers. They smelled so good, and I kept stopping to take pictures of them. I just kept thinking, no one back home is ever going to believe this. I climbed steadily for much of the day, singing my favorite uphill song, 100 Bottles of Beer on the Wall. And before long, I topped out over Pack Train Ridge. The views were 360 degrees, and I totally felt like I was on top of the world. From there, I was above treeline for a while, with nothing but brown rocks surrounding me. I finally caught sight of one of those famous whistling marmots that had been singing us to sleep and awake in the mornings. They're these small, fat, tan and brown, furry things, about the size of a house cat. All in all, I have to tell you, it has been a glorious day of hiking. That was an excerpt from the journal that I kept when I spent some time circling Mt. Rainier in Washington State. So I thought it was high time I shared this amazing place with you. So I want you to sit back, and today we're going to talk all about the Wonderland Trail. My name is Anna Huffmaker. All my friends call me Mudbutt. And you are listening to a Lagniappe episode of the Trail Dames podcast. I'm gonna dance upon this earth. So today we're talking about the Wonderland Trail. And I have to tell you, initially I was drawn to this trail, not because I knew anything about it, but because of its name, the Wonderland Trail. Doesn't it just sound magical? So I convinced my friends Hiker Biker Babe and Silver Lining that we should all go together. And after a year of planning and getting our permits, it was time to get on a plane and go. The Wonderland Trail is this kind of pseudo-circular trail. It's 93 miles long, and it circles all of Mt. Rainier. So like technically, almost most of the time, I'm going to say, you have views of this incredible mountain. So that would be enough to call me to it because that's kind of extraordinary. But honestly, the views, the hiking, everything about it is actually wonderful. Now, it's a really strenuous hike. There's lots and lots of elevation gain and loss. You go through forests and valleys and you go up to these high alpine and subalpine areas. That elevation gain and loss, it is a whopping 22,000 feet. So be prepared. You're going to go uphill and downhill. But the views, they're really just not of this world. So let me tell you, the cool thing about it is that they're constantly changing and everything's different. Like you literally at 1 minute, you'll be hiking through this rich, dark forest, just like in Twilight the movie for all my fellow Twilight fans. And then you'll come out and you'll be in these fields, these rolling fields of waist-high green with all these wildflowers. And then after a little while, you'll go down and you'll have to cross this river or this water crossing, and you have to go down these like sandy, steep banks. And a couple of them, there was actually a rope you had to hold on to. And the water looks like chocolate milk. It's all full of sediment and it's all kind of frothy looking. And then a little while later, you'll actually hike across these giant snow fields because there's snow on the Wonderland Trail for a lot of the year. So you can see that it's constantly changing, and it is so beautiful. I will say that when we went, my friends and I, we were really lucky. The sky was bright blue. I don't think it rained a single time we were there. It was something out of a movie. A lot of times, though, the weather's not quite like that. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But for us, it was kind of a blessed trip, I think. The angels were looking down on us. So for me, one of the things that was super neat about it is really different from East Coast hiking or Appalachian Trail hiking. You know, I'm from Georgia, and I do a lot of my hiking in the Appalachian Mountains or up and down the entire seaboard when I get the opportunity. I've done quite a bit of hiking also in the American Southwest, in the desert. I love that. But this was my first opportunity to ever hike in the Pacific Northwest. And it is really different. The trees are different. The flowers are different. The terrain is different. So that shouldn't be really surprising. But the winter does a serious number on the land every year. It creates an unbelievable amount of blowdowns and debris. And so the trail is, it's this constant, it's gorgeous, but there's also this idea that you just kind of missed a natural disaster, that maybe it happened 2 weeks before. There's like all these fallen trees and stuff. So it's just really different than what I was used to. I will say this too. On the Wonderland Trail, there's no blazes. I don't know if this is a Pacific Northwest thing. It's kind of like, now the trail is very clear, easy to follow. So I wasn't worried about getting lost. But I was kind of surprised at how much I missed those white blazes. You know, I guess you just get really used to them. And of course, I get used to the blue blazes because I'm a blue blaze girl. But on the Wonderland, there's nothing. You may maybe once every day or two, you might see like a little brass plaque on a stick somewhere that says you're nearing a trail crossing. But for the most part, nothing. Nothing that shows that you're, that besides the trail itself, nothing that shows that you're on something that's like planned parkland. So it is kind of actually very wild feeling also. And that's pretty darn great. The water crossings are really different, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But yeah, it's really special hiking. If you haven't had an opportunity, I want you to consider jumping on a plane and making your reservations and going. I will tell you, it's one of the things that's interesting about it is when you go, first of all, you are like carved in stone. You have to stay at certain camp spots. There's all these camp spots, and you have to, when you get your permit beforehand, you have to actually list where you're going to be when. They're very, very serious about that. And the camp spots are really kind of strange. So I had these ideas that my two friends and I would be spread out on these lovely river banks, you know, under the towering trees and everything. And don't get me wrong, it was stunningly beautiful because everything out there is, but it wasn't like that. The campsites, all right, so you know how I mentioned you have all the blowdowns, all the trees and stuff. It's kind of like, so God played pickup sticks with all these trees. And then the park service people, the rangers, the people who work so hard to get this trail ready for us every year, they like clear out areas. So in some places, it actually was almost like being in a really rough log cabin with no roof on it. That's like the trees were stacked up around the camp spots, and the camp spots are small. So a couple of times we actually stayed in the little, in what they call the group site. And with three of us and three tents, we were still a little closer than we normally would like to be. I don't know how in the world they would get 6 to 12 people there. You would have to be really good friends. So in the camp spot itself, you know, you don't really have views there or anything like that. You're just kind of in these little enclosed areas. I found them to be just a little claustrophobic, but you could walk out and there was always a water source at the campsites and a pit toilet. So, and a place to hang your bear bag, whether it be cables or something. So, because yes, there are bears on the Wonderland Trail. We didn't happen to see one, but they are there. So there are also, like I said, there's lots of water crossings. Now, so the cool thing, I was told that a lot of those bridges get washed out or destroyed, whatever, by the winter every year. And they rebuild a lot of them. Those little wooden foot bridges you would see over something, over a creek or a stream, they rebuild them every year. And that to me is kind of amazing. We did have actual water crossings quite a few times, but my most, I'm going to say the word favorite, although that's not really true. My most terrifying water crossing was actually on a swinging suspension bridge. So we went across the suspension bridge. It was early. It was like day two or day three. And this bridge, of course, you know, you're in the middle of nowhere. So it's only maybe, I don't know, 2.5 feet wide. And there's cable railings that you can kind of sort of hold on to. But it goes across this ravine. And it says there's a sign on one end of it. And it says, or probably both ends, actually. And it says, only one person allowed at a time. Well, most of the time, we did not see anybody else on the trail unless we got near like one of the visitor centers. Mostly we had the place to ourselves. But this one morning, there were a couple of guys and they came hiking up behind us. And so it was my turn. I stepped out on this bridge and I started going across. And like my hips, honestly, are like hitting both sides of it. I am nervous. I do not like this. And the bridge started bouncing. And so by the time I got to the middle, all of a sudden, it really started bouncing up and down. And I felt like I was on a roller coaster, but not in a good way. And I got really mad. I was like, that guy behind me ignored the sign and he's on the bridge with me and he is making this worse than it has to be. And I was grabbing one with both hands and I was gritting my teeth. I was just so mad at that guy. I just thought it was so uncool of him. And I finally made it all the way across and I turned around because I was going to give him a piece of my mind. And do you know that guy was still standing over on the other side of the bridge? He wasn't anywhere near it. That bridge bounced that much all by itself. So, of course, I felt bad about, you know, blaming this poor dude. But also, all I could think of was, please don't let there be more bridges like that. That was my one scary moment on the Wonderland Trail. Nobody else seemed to have that kind of problem with the bridge, though. That was just enough. Once was enough for me. So, one of the other cool things about the Wonderland Trail, you know, most people are going to tell you, like, about the gorgeous views and the wildflowers and all this stuff. So one morning, Silver Lining got up and she was mad. When I woke up, she was mad. And she said, there is somebody in one of the camp spots playing an Indian flute. And I was like, really? Because we hadn't seen any other people. You know, supposedly these camp spots were all supposed to be taken, but we hadn't seen anybody. And she says, I got up at like 5:30 in the morning. She said, stomping. And I went and checked all of them and I couldn't find the person, but somebody's playing the flute. And finally, I told her, I said, I think that those are the whistling marmots. This place is famous for whistling marmots. And so she's like, nope, not possible. Has to be a whistle. Has to be a flute. And I'm like, I'm pretty sure we're the only people for, I don't know, 30 miles around. So anyway, turns out, I don't know if what she heard was a flute player or not, but we did see and hear the whistling marmots quite a bit on our trip. And they're pretty cool because we don't have those on the East Coast either. So I will say the logistics of hiking this, very interesting. Again, not like the Appalachian Trail. You know, on the AT, you're always within 2 to 5 days of food, a ride into town, a shower. This isn't like that. There is no easily accessible food on the trail, basically. There's two spots where you can get basic supplies. There are visitor centers if they're open. And that's a big if, especially right now with COVID. So you have to cache your food. And they actually give you these really intense instructions on the Park Service website, how to pack it. And you go a day early and you end up, you leave it places. So if you do the Wonderland Trail, that's one of the first things you got to do. You got to plan out your food and you got to plan where you're going to stash it. Also know you cannot cache your fuel with your food. It's got to be separate. So they have pretty intense rules about all that. The weather, like I said earlier, you know, the area is Pacific Northwest. We've all seen the movies. It gets lots of rain. It's cloudy a lot of the time. We didn't experience that, but I think we were like, you know, a little bit, we were actually quite a bit lucky. But you can also expect some snow on at least some portions of the trail through late July. We went in late July, I believe it was. And the interesting thing was, I will say this, we read everything we could find, of course. And a lot of things I read said, you might need an ice axe, that there would be times when you would go across areas that were snowy and icy. And that scared the mess out of me. Because if you were ever listening to this podcast and you've heard any of the stuff we do about winter hiking, I am not a winter girl. I'm not a snow girl. My name attests the fact that I fall down a lot. And so I was actually kind of worried about that. And so I have a friend here in Georgia named Alpine, and Alpine is a serious ice climber. And he knows a lot about this stuff. And he's like, no big deal, Anna. He said, I'll loan you an ice axe. And I'm like, really? Yeah, I'll loan you an ice axe. So sure enough, he loans me this shiny, beautiful orange and silver ice axe. Now, he did not teach me how to use it, and I didn't bother to learn how to use it because that didn't even occur to me. All I knew is I had my ice axe, and, you know, then I was prepared. Well, when we got to the Wonderland Trail and signed in and got our official permit, I was talking to the ranger, and I said, how much snow and ice is actually on the trail right now? And he says, not a lot. And he explained to me this particular Alpine Meadows is covered with snow in this one. And I said, so I don't need an ice axe. And he looked at me and he goes, do you know how to use that ice axe? And I went, absolutely not. And he said, I highly suggest you just leave that in the car. And I said, okay, because I know one thing. I may do stupid things in the beginning, but when park rangers correct me and tell me what to do, I always listen to them. They're way smarter than me. So I did not end up needing it, of course, at all. And walked through the fields, the places with the snow that I went through were fairly flat. They weren't on a slope. There's nothing dangerous. So, but you got to know, you got to look at what the winter was like beforehand and what your spring thaw has been like, because you could end up dealing with ice and with snow. And you just want to be prepared. So I want to tell you, like, one of the cool things is that we did have to do some water crossings. The ones we had to do were fairly small, but still actually for me, kind of super nerve-wracking. And here's the thing. Have you ever heard people talk about you can hear the boulders rolling along at the bottom of a river, of a swiftly rolling river? I had heard that description, but I had never experienced it. And I couldn't really imagine it because I know that water is strong and powerful, but the idea of it actually rolling boulders didn't really compute in my head. Well, we came to several crossings, and I think probably in the height of the spring thaw, it was one giant river, but for us, it was several small crossings. And one of them you could jump across. That took me a long time to get up enough courage to do. But then one of them, when we got to it, it sounded like there was thunder. And like the sky was bright blue with these little white poofy clouds, not a raindrop in sight, but I kept hearing thunder. And I told Hiker Biker Babe, I said, is that thunder? Do you think that, you know, on the other side of the mountain, there's a storm or, you know? And she says, no, she says, that's the boulders rolling along the bottom of this water. And I was like, are you serious? She says, yeah. And, you know, I mentioned earlier, the water is super interesting. It looks like chocolate milk. So this is not the clear, pristine streams of some of the other parks I've traveled or hiked in. Chocolate milk with white froth, and it's because there's so much sediment in it. Oh, which, like, let me just back up for just a second. Keep that in mind when you're selecting your water purification method, because this water will just clog up a filter faster than you can say Wonderland, because it's got so much in it. And all this is coming down off of the mountain, and it's all spring thaw and just intensely crazy water. So I can remember going through one that was only a little over knee high. So that's not particularly deep, but it probably was only 10 feet across, 12 feet across. A lot of you guys are sitting there going, huh, that's no big deal. Let me tell you, when the water just is constantly pushing your hiking poles out, like you can't even plant them, that's powerful water. So be prepared to do some water crossings when you go. Just learn how to do it. Make sure you know what you're doing. Undo your waist belt, plant those poles, and go slowly, one step at a time. So I want to tell you a few things that you do need to know if you decide to go do the Wonderland Trail. Right now, because of COVID, I mean, you know, everything across the country is kind of up in the air and weird. Right now, the Wonderland Trail, the roads are open and the trailheads are open and the toilets at the trailheads are open. but the park visitor centers are not, and the Paradise Inn is not, that's going to really affect how you deal with your food, how you deal with your transportation in and out, and that kind of thing. So if you decide to go, the first thing you're going to want to do is go to the Park Service website and look at the most updated information you can find. I put the link to that in the show notes so you can look at that. You have to hike basically summer to early fall. That is your window of opportunity. I can't imagine what this trail looks like in the winter, but normal people don't hike it. So just those crazy, amazing winter hiker people do it. It normally takes about 10 days or so. The park allows you up to 14. You can't take longer than that. And like I said earlier, your trip is going to really be defined by the campsite's availability and their placement. So you want to look at that and look at the mileage you think you can do every day. Remember, if you're like me and you're just like a normal everyday curvy 52-year-old hiker, the mileage between the sites, look at it closely because there's a lot of up and down, lot of up and down. I thought the trail was actually shockingly well maintained. My head and heart just go out to all the people that made that possible after the winter they have every year. However, it's still a fairly intense hiking trail. So I said you had to camp at one of the campsites. That's true. They do tell you they have some group sites. You can try and hike this with a group. I think it would be pretty tough. Like I said, the campsites are small. You know, with three of us was kind of perfect. The big thing to know, this is a highly permitted trail, and permits are not easy to get. So for us, and this was several years ago when we went, it wasn't so bad, but things have gotten pretty intense. You have to get their permit beforehand. They do not issue walk-up permits. This really requires pre-planning. But here's where it gets interesting. You have this really small window in which to request a permit. You need to request it between 7 and 31 days before you want to start. So if I wanted to go on August 1st, I start sending in my permit request the beginning of July. That makes it difficult if you got to fly in, you're dealing with plane tickets and that kind of thing. But let me just tell you, this trail is worth it. It's worth any of the hoops you got to jump through. It's worth the $20 registration fee you got to pay. It's an incredible trail. And let's pretend you bought that plane ticket and you were just like rolling the dice and you tried to get your permit and you found out 2 days before that you didn't get it. I got to tell you, oh my gosh, the Pacific Northwest has a zillion stunning hiking trails. Everything from over on the coast, the Ho National Forest, which we went backpacking in. Also, I'll talk about that another day. Like, just, it's stunningly beautiful. So you should just plan on going anyway. Oh, a couple more things you do need to know real quickly. No hitchhiking is allowed in the park. But I have to tell you, so there's a website called thewonderlandguides.com. And this is like the best website I found for planning your trip. They've got all kind of great information. I put their link in the show notes also for you. But they have a quote on there when they're talking about hitchhiking. And it says, quote unquote, "If you somehow get stranded somewhere in the park, there's no law against being friendly and asking for rides from strangers at the tourist stops. Look for people who have bumper stickers of multicolored dancing teddy bears," unquote. I just love that because you know that's true. So also if they have 500, you know, Save the Earth bumper stickers, you could probably count on that being a possible ride. There is no cell service pretty much at all. Assume that there will be zero and there's definitely no Wi-Fi unless things have really recently changed. You're pretty much... You're going out there, you know, go out there, enjoy it. You don't need to check Facebook while you're there. So if you are into climbing, like true ice climbing and going back a glacier, that requires a whole different set of rules and permits. You need to check out the website for details. I don't know anything about all that. So I will say that my trip around Wonderland, it was actually cut short by a really brutal case of Giardia. That's a trail story nobody really wants to hear. Maybe I'll tell one day on a Trail Dame story episode. But I had to get off the trail and it was fairly miserable. But that trail is still calling me. It is on my very short list of must hikes. And the next time I'm in Washington State, I'm going for it. Trust me when I tell you, this is a hike you really want to try and do. So if you've hiked the Wonderland, let us know about it. I'd love to hear about your stories, see your pictures. You can reach me either at thehikingradionetwork.com or info@traildames.com. You can email me there. Finally, so did you know that this podcast was the brainchild of Steve Adams, aka Mighty Blue? He produces the Trail Dames podcast as well as all the other podcasts on the Hiking Radio Network. And you know what? He does it for free. He's created a world of podcasts. They're all full of hiking news and resources, stories, amazing people. And he did it because he just loves this hiking and backpacking world. So please consider going to www.hikingradionetwork.com and making good use of our new donate button. All the funds go to Steve and the costs that he accrues. Not only is he producing all these shows, but he is also funding the recording and the hosting and the website costs. Thank you, Steve. We truly couldn't do this without you. Once again, that's www.hikingradionetwork.com. The donate button allows you to go to PayPal. You can support these podcasts with either a one-time donation or a monthly subscription gift. Thank you guys so much. Once again, I'm Anna Huthmaker. All my friends call me Mudbutt. And I'm looking forward to seeing you again soon on the next episode of the Trail Dames podcast.